So when it comes to managing the secondary storage or mass storage, right? So there's a huge amount of space, right? And when we have a large amount of space and large amount of files saved, right? So there should be efficient mechanism to retrieve the data as well as write the data into the disk, right? So therefore, one key factor to the performance of the operating system would be managing this mass storage, right? So when it comes to read-write operations in the secondary storage or mass storage, right? So it should be done very efficiently. If not, it will be a delay that affects the whole performance of the operating system, right? So therefore, the important characteristics would be the transfer rate, right? So the data is being transferred from the drive to the main memory from the main memory to the secondary storage, right? So those are very important characteristics, right? And also the position in time. So how long will it take to read and write data from and to the secondary storage, right? So first we have to find the proper places to read or and also find the proper places to write, right? So this is not that simple, right? When it comes to identifying proper locations, and this has to be done in milliseconds, right? Sometimes in nanoseconds. So it takes time. So time that takes to find a proper place to read write, we call it as seek time, right? So first the instructions will come to find the location, then it will take time to read or write from or to the disk. So that is actually, we call it as the rotational latency, right? So it will take some time to identify the proper sector of a disk to be written or read, right? So this will take some time, and that is called as rotational latency. There will be a delay, right? But the delay should be minimal if the operating system wants to perform well. So the heads that I will show you in next few slides, the structure of the secondary storage. So heads will be rotating, right, and searching for the proper sectors to be read write. Then sometimes the heads can crash, right? So there are different ways, right? So since it is always rotating, right, so there will be a lifetime, right, for a head, right, or the heads in the secondary storage. So it can crash. Sometimes you may lose data, right? But somehow there are mechanisms that we can protect the data. We can duplicate the data and make them highly available and run the system smoothly. So this is how a disk look like, right? So there's a arm. So the arm read write heads are attached to it. So each platter, right, is consisting with sectors, right? So when the head is moving into different locations, so it is moving into cylinders. So you can see a cylinder, right? So cylinder will indicate parallel sectors that can access by the head of each of these platter separately, right? So there can be multiple reads happening in each platter, that is referring to each cylinder, right? So there will be number of tracks accessible for in a given cylinder for each head, so it can retrieve the data and send to the main memory, or if there's a write instruction, it will write the data into the necessary sector, right? So that is the structure. So when it comes to the disk structure, right, so there will be a large array of logical blocks, right? So it has a given size, right? So the block is what we are going to use, what the secondary storage will be using to store the data, right? So the logical blocks are mapped into the physical sectors in the disk, right? So the first sector will be starting from zero, right? And then it goes around to indicate the maximum number of sectors, right? So the zeroth sector is considered the first sector in the first track of the outmost cylinder, right? So then each track will have number of sectors, right? So like that, the structure is being arranged. So each of these logical blocks will be mapped into a sector. So that is being again managed by the volume, right? The partition. So reading and writing data to the secondary storage, as I mentioned earlier, it's very important, right? So therefore it has to be managed properly. Fast response is very important to retrieve data, right? So seek time. So how much time it will spend to find the data, right, is critical, right? So the rotational latency will indicate the waiting time to search for the current or search for the current need of data or the file, and how much it will take to how much time it will take to retrieve the data, right? So the goal should be to minimize the seek time, right? We have to minimize the time that it takes to find the data, right? So this is proportionate to the seek distance. So how much the distance will be proportionate to the seek time as well. So if we can measure the seek distance and reduce the seek distance, then that means that seek time will be reduced, because seek distance we can measure, right? Because we know the sectors, cylinders, and all these are numbers. So based on the numbers, we can identify how long it will take to, or how the distance between those two. So that will directly affect the seek time, right? And also a disk will have a bandwidth, the total number of bytes that can be transferred from the device to the main memory, or from the main memory to the disk to be written into the disk, right? So like that. So disk scheduling, right, also critical. Therefore, there are criteria. So there are certain algorithms that we can use to identify and calculate the seek distance. If the seek distance is large, that means the seek time will be also, there will be a large seek time, right? So we will see what are the available algorithms now for disk scheduling. So the first algorithm that we will discuss would be first come, first serve. And this is what we have, right? So we have a number of sectors starting from 0 to 199, right? And then this is the sequence of sectors we need to access, starting from 98, 8, 183, 37, 122, and like that. So the head pointer, so that means the current position of the head is 53rd sector, right? Current position is 53rd. Then we need to consider first come, first serve to see how the access is done, right, using the head movement. So starting from 53, head starts at 53. From 53, it has to go to 98, 53 to 98, right? And then 98 to 183, 183 to 37, Right? So that is first come first serve. Starting from the head, 53, right? So this is the sequence of sectors to be referred. Then we can draw the, we can draw a chart, right? So these are the sector numbers, right? So vertical axis would be the time, right? So it will take some time to access. So that is the time. So how do we calculate the time? Time calculation is not possible, right? So what we do is we can calculate the head movement. How? From 53 to 98. So when we reduce 98, so when we reduce 53 from 98, we can calculate this distance. Then 98 to 183. When we reduce 98 from 183, we can calculate this distance. So like that, we can calculate the distance. So when we calculate, it takes 640. Right? So there's another algorithm. Shortest seek time first. Right? So in this algorithm, what it checks is it will check the shortest distance in terms of the next reference, right? Or next referred sector, right? And then it moves into that particular sector, read the data, then again check for the shortest distance. So this is based on the shortest distance, right? So in CPU scheduling, this is like the shortest job first, right? So I can illustrate them by using this example. 53 again is the starting head, right? And this is the given string. So then we need to calculate which one is having the shortest distance to the 53rd sector. So 53 is here. Then we need to do the calculation. So either it would be 65 or 37. So it is closer to 65 because this has shortest distance, right? So this has only 12 sectors. This has more than 12, 37, right? So the head moves to 65, read the value, then again check for the shortest distance, 67, right? Shortest, read the value, then from 67, it will check whether it is 98 or 37. Right? So it is 37, right? So the difference between 37 and 67 is 30. So it is closer to 37, right? So then it moves to 37. From 37, again, it will check whether it is 14 or 98. So it is closer to 14. Goes to 14. Then calculate and see the shortest distance. So all the others are very far, right? The shortest would be 98. So it goes from 14 to 98 to 122, 122 to 124, 183. So again, we can calculate the distance, right? By taking the difference between these two, 65 minus 53, right? Plus 67 minus 65. Right, then 67 minus 37, 37 minus 14. So like that, we can calculate the total head movement. Right, so when you calculate, it would be 236. Right, so that is shortest seek time first. Then there's another algorithm, right? This is called as scan. So scan will identify whether to move upwards or downwards, right? Based on the distances available, right? So it will check which would be the lowest sector and which would be the highest. So based on that, we can take the difference between the current position and the lowest current position and the highest. So based on that, we can decide which direction it should go. So it will take the decision of the direction, right, based on the highest and the lowest distance and the difference, right? If the difference is low in lowest one, go to that direction, right? So based on that, the scan algorithm works. Sometimes this is called as the elevator algorithm because this is like an elevator. So it will take the decision for the direction, goes in that direction by serving all the available sectors, then change the direction and serve all the sectors in the other directions and goes to the maximum, right? So if I explain it by using the same example, starting point is 53, right? So the lowest would be 0, highest would be 199, right? So then from these two directions, which would be the closest would be 0, right? Because 199 is far away, 0 is the closest, so it takes this direction. Coming from 53 to 0, while coming into 0, it will read 37, 14, comes to 0, then turns the other way, comes back to 65, 67, like that, it will read all the other values. So this is called as scan. Right, so first it will take the decision for the direction based on the closest boundary, then read all the instruction or read all the sectors in that direction, comes to the end, then turn the direction to the other way, start going in to the maximum number by reading all the sectors available in that direction, right? So that is scan. So there's another algorithm that is called as C-scan, right? So here, the difference is, it will start from one end to the other end, right? And then when it reaches to the maximum, it comes back to the beginning and starts serving until all the requests are served. Right? So, in an example, if I show you this C-scan algorithm, we can see starting from 53, it goes upwards. It goes till the end. Right? So, it goes till the end by serving all the sectors, reading or writing all sectors until 199, then comes to the beginning, right? So it comes back to the beginning and then again reads and goes forward and read all the necessary sectors until all are served. Right, so that is C scan. So the difference between scan and C scan, scan first, it will determine the direction, whether it is to go upwards or downwards based on the closest boundary, whether it is 0, 199 is closest, that is scan. Then start servicing that direction until it comes to the boundary, then change the direction. But here it always goes upwards, right, one to the other, it goes upwards, and when it reaches the maximum sector, it goes back to zero, start upwards again, right? That is C scan. There's another version called C look. So, right, so C look is actually another version of C scan. So the difference is it doesn't go to the end like C scan, but it will go to the last request in that direction, right? Then it comes back to the smallest or the lowest of sectors and go forward after that, right? So the difference is that, right? So in C scan, it goes until you search the, or you reach the maximum, right? But here it does not go to the maximum. It stopped at the last sector, then comes back to the lower sector. It does not come back to zero like C scan. It stays at 14 and turns the direction, right? Change the direction and serve all the necessary necessary sectors, right? That is C look. Right, so when it comes to selecting a scheduling algorithm, right? So shortest seek time first is commonly used, right, in operating systems, and also C scan and scan are also has better performance when there are heavy load, right? So the requests are not just 10 to 12 read write instructions, there can be many, right? So it actually comes as a string. So therefore scan and C scan would be better. Performance again will be depending on the number of types of requests, right? Number based on the given stream of requests to read write. So this scheduling is very important, as you have seen, right? So it will be based on the operating system. So the operating system will determine which particular algorithm will be used in a particular given situation, right? So by considering all these available algorithms, shortest seek time first or C look, right? It looks reasonable to start, right, a descheduling. Then based on the performance, it may be changed time to time. Right, so then another important aspect in disk management is called as RAID, right? So RAID stands for redundant array of independent disks, right? So there are different RAID mechanisms available in computer systems, hardware RAID as well as software RAID, right? So there are different RAID levels available. So starting from RAID 0 to RAID 10. So briefly explain, if I explain regarding RAID 0, RAID 0, we call it as strapping mechanism. That means we can connect multiple physical disks into a single partition, right? So there's no redundancy, but we can improve the contiguous storage. right? So like that, that is RAID 0. RAID 1 is called as mirroring. That means an exact copy of one disk will be available real time in another similar capacity disk. So one-to-one copy will be maintained, right? So therefore, the redundancy is 100%, right? If one disk fails, the other one can take the tasks and do the operations, right? So high availability is there. And there are different RAID mechanisms, right? RAID 4, 5, 6. So the important RAID types would be RAID 0, RAID 1, RAID 5, and also RAID 10. So RAID 10 is a combination of RAID 1 and 0, right? So that is called as a stripped mirror. So I would like to give this as homework to you. So you can refer to these different types of RAIDing mechanisms and understand. If you have any questions, right, we can discuss again.